What's up, everyone? Welcome to another Culture Cut TV. I'm Static Link.
And you know, it's your boy, Rich Furniss. And today I'm very excited to bring a close friend of mine, Sarah, in the building with us today.
Hi, guys. I was a little early. I was excited.
Oh, yeah, a little early.
Well, we're excited to have you. That's why Rick was super loud again.
I have one volume. Loud, yeah. It's just always loud.
He's always a loud guy. He's excited.
I haven't seen Sarah in like a year, so I'm excited to have
her.
I'm
like, it's warranted.
Yeah.
You know?
It's all love.
I'm excited to learn more about what you and what you do with your promotional company and everything like that that you're running. So let's go ahead and get into the first video.
For the first video, I haven't told anybody. So, you know, we've been doing a long standing of only my music videos. So for this, we're going to go ahead. I love the way this video is shot. I love the beat. We're going to go Jack Harlow Tectral, right?
Oh, yeah, nice. I do not listen to Jack Harlow. This will be a first for me.
I fell in love with this based off of the music video alone, and then I liked the song because the music video was so fire.
Perfect. All right, right here in Culture Cut. Jack Harlow with Nail Tech. What a great video, man.
I just love somebody who does color. I love the coloring on this, and then also it's very cinematic, like how they shot everything. It's like a bunch of different parts from a movie, almost like a trailer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really cool. Mm-hmm. It's almost got like a vintage effect on it too, with the saturation.
With the saturation, yeah.
Yeah, and it's interesting. We were talking off camera how big Jack Harlow's become, man. He's blowing up, man. It's crazy. I feel like I hear his name all the time now.
Right. I'm like, it's interesting because I don't really listen to his music per se, but I feel like I'm always hearing about Jack Harlow. Yeah. Like, he's one of those, like...
Me too.
Yeah. I don't know if he's, like, the new, like, hot boy in terms of, like who everyone's attracted to. Because it's weird. I'm like, is he a great performer? Is that what it is, like, live?
I hear he's a really good performer. I actually had never listened to him before John, Proper Villain, showed me this music video. Mm. And I fell in love with the music video. And then I went down a rabbit hole of, like, looking into his music, like, his Lyrical Lemonade music videos.
Well,
he actually
is really interesting because he actually did some stuff with Static Selecta. So he's done some stuff on the underground hip-hop scene, too, which is kind of weird because he went from Static Selecta and now he's doing stuff with Drake and doing, like, more, like,
poppy
music, I guess. Pop, hip-hop.
So he's earned his respect a little bit.
Yeah, for sure, for sure.
So I'm excited to have Sarah here. Sarah, you've worked in every aspect of the music industry. You know what I mean? You've been around us since you were young. You know what I mean? You've worked help with promotion. You also do film and music videos and work with a lot of really cool artists. So how did you get into music? I guess mostly from your upbringing?
Yeah. So in terms of like in a professional sense, I actually really wanted to avoid it.
Yeah. Is it because you were around it so much growing
up?
Yeah.
Like I was like, my mom owned two studios. She was a tour manager, but she also like was a singer when she was coming up and like vocal coach. So I was a kid that would like come home from school and like immediately go to the studio and be annoyed because like someone couldn't get down their riff and I'm hearing it like recorded like
a million,
like,
times.
You know, a million times. I know. And I'm just like, I just want McDonald's. Like, I want a snack. Like, you know, it's just like being at your parents' job. But it's one of those things where like I've always like really enjoyed music. So I went to school in Chicago, which is probably one of the greatest places to be for like a music scene because everybody hits it on the tour circuit.
It's real.
Particularly for the Midwest. And there's just a lot of like long-standing, like traditional music venues. So it was a great time to like be in Chicago. It was like 2009 to like 2014.
It's close to the time I was out there as well. Hell
it's
yeah.
Like, yeah,
well,
you had
got me
like
into it as well. I always say I found my style of how I do music now from Chicago.
Yeah, so it's like, you know, you had all these like factions. You had like drill really getting popular. Like I personally was like living on like 55th and Ingleside, so it wasn't too far from like 47th Street. So there was just like a lot of crossover. And then it turns out that a lot of my friends from college ended up working in music. And we did not go to like a music school at all. Like we go to the school, like University of Chicago. The motto is, it's where fun goes to die.
Yo,
and so like we went to a nerdy ass school. Excuse me, am I allowed to curse?
Yes.
Okay. And so it was one of those things, but after college, I actually started working in healthcare. And all of my friends were like music writers and Like sort of like A&Rs, or like we're just like starting to like manage artists. And because I grew up in that, I always wanted to avoid managing artists because I'm like, no, it's not the life for me. But just hanging out with them, I always was going to free shows. It kind of pushed me back into PR because I knew how, like, you know, when you see people work at a certain level, you know, like, okay, this is how things are supposed to be done. And a lot of times I had friends that were artists or were like helping out artists, and I was just like, no, like, this is how you're supposed to do it, or like, this is the type of deal you should be looking for, like, this is how you should be shooting your videos. And eventually it just made sense. Like, I was working at the hospital and like doing PR like part time, and eventually I kind of was like, you know, I'm not gonna be a doctor, I don't wanna go to medical school, and decided to switch over into a creative field, but realized very quickly that I liked film and I sort of liked the ideation and strategy behind it. And so production gave me a really...
I think you're a puzzle master, and I think your biggest strength is you're very good at being able to figure out all the pieces on the board and where they fit together. And that can fit into music, or it can fit into videos, or it can fit into other corporate lifestyle jobs. But that's definitely what I feel like your strength has always been.
Yeah, thank you. It, like, it made it easy because then I was like, I could touch all these things, but I don't have to be like fully involved. Because that's one thing I will say, like, anybody that's looking to get into the music industry, it's a lifestyle. You know, it's like you can't just turn it off. You, as much as we want to talk about money, if you're managing artists, if you're working for artists, it's 24/7, whether you're getting paid or not. Like, yeah, it's one of those things where it's like you're always on call. And so, production allows me to be on call in ways that I actually want to be on call.
What I love what you just said too, which is interesting. So it's like, it's almost like you weren't searching for it. It just kind of happened. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a natural progression for you, and you were just happened to notice you're good at this, and people were gravitating towards you to do this particular thing, and just kind of happened.
Yeah, yeah. But I always say that like music is like a first or second love in terms of just like sound and like sonic. And I think that like that's for anybody. Like if you really enjoy music, I say there's people that are active listeners and then they're passive listeners. Mm-hmm. And you sort of like can't help it if you're an active listener just to be drawn.
Sure.
Because I feel like there's so many good ears, you know, like out in the world. And it's like you can be a really good ear and still never want to touch the industry. So I always like pride myself.
Sometimes it's better to keep it sacred as well. You know what I mean? Because as soon as something becomes a job, then it is a job. And like you said, a lot of things with music, and I think, you know, good advice for people out here who are thinking of getting into the industry, no matter what part of it is, like you said, it's something that is 24/7. It is something that is a lifestyle. Whether you work on the management side or the artist side, it's something that you're always being looked at, and you're always, if you really love this, it's something you're gonna have to constantly work at every minute of every day.
Definitely, and I think also too, it's important to have the passive listeners, you know, like you were saying, because like, dude, those are the best people. Like, I love playing my music for them because like, it's not somebody saying, oh, you're not following this particular trend. It either sounds good or it doesn't sound good, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're like, oh, I like it or I don't like it, or I like this part and I don't like this part. And you're not like analyzing it from a business sense. You know, I think with us particularly, we're around people all day that do music for their job. So it's like, it's good to have somebody who is from the outside looking in, like you were saying, that just like enjoys music.
I send it to family members for that exact reason. Whenever I'm like sending demos out, I'll send it to you, John, Lefty, all those guys. And then I'll send it like to my uncle, like, hey, what do you think of this? You know what I mean? My cousin or something who is far enough removed from the industry where they're not gonna be like, well, I don't know if the structure is gonna work that great. You know, they're like, oh yeah, this is really cool. I really like that little hooky thing you did there.
Or the mix or the technical mixing or whatever it may be. So for the film stuff, so do you find yourself, you know, as are you doing consulting work for some artists for the film side as well? Or I know you said you do a little film work as well.
So for the film, it's more like creative production.
Oh, nice.
So yeah, mainly just like putting the puzzle together.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm gonna steal that. That was great.
Patton, you heard it here first.
Rick's dropping gems all the time, you know.
Hey.
But yeah, just mainly like putting the puzzle together. I like dabble in like directing. I don't have any like real official credits, but I've like done some small stuff just on the personal side. But
I mean, how many times you end up not having a credit, but you end up having to direct something?
That's true. I will say, girl is a fire AD. Let me tell you. But yeah, no, I don't know. Film is just like it's a happy medium for me. I think being a Black woman, it's cool to be able to like be a part of like building a narrative, because there's so many parts I think in production that like I didn't realize, from like color to like editing styles, to like sound design. And so like all of that contributes to like what people feel and see and hear when they like try to break down a film. So I don't know, like film production is just a really great way for me to be creative in a non-creative way, if that makes sense.
That's
like
totally makes sense, yeah.
Give notes and give ideas that help guide and lead, but like I still didn't have to go to film school for it.
Sure. So, well, sometimes it's the best, you know what I mean? Sometimes yeah. it's good to learn those things on the job, you know what
mm-hmm.
I mean?
I think it's the best way, honestly.
More creative, honestly, you know, I think that's great. All right, Sarah, well, why don't we do this? Why don't we get into your first music video? What do you got for
yes.
us?
Yes. So I have a great friend of mine. His name is Cindy Cologne, and he just dropped a project called Flower Bug, and this is one of the videos from the project. I think it's, oh God, Tongue Twister. I can't think off the top of my tongue, but what do you call it? It's like the leading video, not the single, but maybe the single. I don't know. I'm
we'll
sorry, Sunny. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
Not helping your rollout, but it's a really fire project and it's beautifully shot. And my homie did it, so.
Even better. We love, let's we watch love it, guys. Plugging the homies on this show, so let's do it all.
Yo, that was a very fire video. And one thing I will say is I like the pacing of it. Like you said, it's like a lot of very beautiful shots. I feel like a lot of indie artists specifically have been doing that where they've, instead of trying to fit so much into one music video, they do very little, but do it very cinematically and mm-hmm. very pretty. And I can really appreciate that.
The beat was fire too, actually. The production was really good. Yeah. Is he the producer as well?
Yeah, or? He actually produces most of his music.
Wow, that's great. The guitar was awesome. Very catchy. Acoustic guitar. I like it a lot. It was really good. So good choice. See, we like it when you plug your friends on
here
because we discover great music that way, and hopefully our audience discovers great music that way as well. So
I know.
That's good.
I hope you guys check them out.
One thing we really like to talk about on the show, obviously, is how to help up-and-coming artists, you know, and kind of give them a little advice from people who are active in the industry. And you've already touched on and dropped some amazing gems throughout the show about being yourself and creativity and that kind of thing. What are some things you think for somebody who's brand new getting into music in 2022? Let's say they were like, I want to make it a career. What's some advice you would have for somebody like that? Because I feel like we've had people on the show who come from like, you know, a music education background. And then what I like from you is you come from a build yourself ground up grassroots style mm-hmm. thing. Yeah. So this will be an awesome take on that side.
I am going to say, which I think is probably an old school answer. I think one of the most important things is artist development. Mm. So right now there's just a lot of saturation in the industry, so which is always going to be a thing. But I think it's really like making sure you have a great stage presence and also figuring out what type of artist you want to be. Are you going to be a performer? Mm. If you're not going to be a performer, then how do you connect with your audience? Do you want to utilize visuals? Like everyone screams content, but the thing is that like if your content isn't worthwhile in the sense of like your audience can understand that like, oh, like I understand why they're doing this and this is the narrative and like we feel closer to you. If you're just like shooting out a bunch of videos at us, it's like it's too much. So I think be really intentional about what type of relationship you want to have with your fans. And yes, I say fans because you're going to need them. And tour. Like, I know it's hard, but if you can easily put together like a 5-city tour or like a 5-bar tour in your city or like neighbor, like surrounding cities, like you really just need to build like genuine enthusiasm, a genuine fan base, because like followers don't necessarily mean that anyone's going to buy your stuff. Followers don't mean that anyone is necessarily going to show up to your shows,
but building
an authentic like fan base and spending the time. Because I think what my mom always used to say is like, if you're an artist, you're an artist. Whether you pop off in 2 years or 6 months, it doesn't matter because you're still an artist. So I feel like if you're true to yourself in terms of like, hey, I'm giving myself this amount of time to break or do this, and just be intentional about, you know, what you're putting out, who you're reaching and how you're reaching them, and that it makes sense for you as well. Because if you can't keep up with it and be consistent with it, then it's also not gonna work. Like
consistency is everything.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. I mean, so correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds like artist identity is like a really important part.
Yeah, just
connecting
like,
with your audience.
Yeah, just being intentional with your development. Like, I'm like, it takes time, you know, like 7 years ago, Doja Cat was crying about people not buying her EP and like having to live at home. And now like she's probably going to be like one of the next major like pop stars, you know, that has some longevity. And I also just want to remind people that a lot of people that we see that we think, oh, they just broke. It's like, it's really, really rare in the industry that people break like that.
Usually
like,
they've been in it in some way or another for
people have been writing 10, 20 years. Like have been writing for 5 years or producing for other people or just like in the mix. And it's like, you have no idea. Like a lot of times, like I have somebody that had like a viral song that they were able to sell. And the song has been maybe viral for like years. They did Coachella, they came out on stages, but they're pretty much an unknown artist, but you would never know that they wrote this song. So I feel like that happens all the time. And it's more about like curating like who you really, really want to be and just taking the time to do it. Like it's not easy, it's never going to be easy, but I think no career, nothing in life is easy.
Sure.
And yeah. I have to just say like fail upwards. As long as you're progressively failing, then like you'll be okay.
You learn from those mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
It's important part of the development. It's funny because we were actually talking off camera before you got here with another artist that teaches at the school here about how important it is to stay true to your artist identity and not chase trends. Because if you chase trends, you can make a good career out of it. I mean, as a producer, I know a lot of other producers who chase trends with beats and they sell lots of beats on BeatStars and they're making profits, but they're not really known for a particular sound because they continuously chase what's hot. You know, at one point they're making Travis Scott style beats, the next thing they're making, you know, like Griselda, like boom bap style beats, you know what I mean? And it's like you're chasing those trends so often that like you kind of lose focus on who you are. And I think that's part of the development phase. Like you're saying, it's really important for you to develop and understand that it takes time, you know, to
pre-production.
Build. Yeah, it's super important.
Let me tell you about the pre-production.
one thing that I liked, and I think you would probably have a good you know, viewpoint on this. You were kind of talking about the artist image and I guess a lot of the pre-production, like how do you think an artist should go about creating or developing the plan for the media that they want to create? Because that's such a big part of it now. I know you deal with it, not just in the music world, but also within corporate video and all that kind of stuff. What's like the biggest point to be able to tell that story and like know what's enough content? What content do I put out?
I think it's really kind of understanding like what can you do in terms of a rollout? So like if you have a video and you are like, the song sounds like summer, but you know that summer is really competitive in terms of like rollouts. I would really sort of sit down and say, all right, well, how much money do I have to push for like advertisement? And if this is going to be like a project drop versus a single drop versus a video drop, then like, do I want to drop like a 30-second teaser of the video outside of the full video? And sort of just like plan it out that like even if it's like one video or one song, you can push that one entity for 6 to 8 months. And I mean, for a real good rollout, it's like the prep is at least 3 months.
Mm-hmm. That's
so
very real.
It's like, I feel like if you really were like, I only have maybe this budget is important. I think being realistic with yourself and saying like, okay, this is the budget I have for like advertising. This is the budget that I have for actual like video production or music production. And then this is, you know, what I have for maybe like touring. I think reaching out to like, you know, we are coming out of a pandemic. I would say like there are a lot of people that are looking for connection. I think the restart is great for, you know, the music and film industry, because I would say reach out to a lot of like local art museum, bars, cafe shops, you know, people that do programming, and just say, hey, like I have a small EP, I have something I want to present, or I'm doing this. And I think reach across your network. But most important thing is understanding what your rollout is, how you want to do a rollout. If you are confident enough, figure out who does music sync. I think one of the greatest things for unknown artists is that all of these TV shows, nobody wants to pay the licensing for these large songs, like, you know, these really big, like, popular songs, unless they're feature films. So it's a lot easier to get your music on, like, episodic content and series, you know, VH1, BET, all of that. But I would just be looking for the people. Like, you can type in Music Sync on Twitter and figure out who these people are.
Or LinkedIn.
And LinkedIn, and sort of figure out, like, how they pick their songs, you know, like, reach out to local DJs and let them know, like, hey, I have a track. Can I send you the stems? And, like, let you know, like, people don't realize that, like, street teams are much more important now than ever because, you know, any given Friday, I lock into whatever music app I'm listening to and I'm overwhelmed by, like, all these suggestions and playlists. So you really have to connect with your demographic and your listener on a real level. And that's how you build engagement. I mean, like, and it's a lot easier because then at least you have people that are willing to put money back into your pockets, even if it's just $5 to $12 on Bandcamp or something else. Like, that is much more real than you getting, like, cents on the dollar for streaming.
That's a clip right there.
That's a clap.
That's really good. Yeah, that was really good knowledge. That's so important. I mean, even, you know, myself, like, with the sample pack stuff that I do, and I know Rich does this with his stuff, we try to keep it grassroots. You know what I mean? Like, really get the community to engage because you're right. Like, stopping yourself to playlists nowadays, even though it's an important part of the process, I would say grassroots movements way more important. And reaching out, everything you said about reaching out to people and engaging with your fans, like you said earlier in the show, is so important.
Build the community.
Oh my God, that's mm-hmm. like, it's that is such a good point that I think gets overlooked quite a bit in the playlist era, you know? It's great. Well, before we close out the show and offer your final thoughts, I'm gonna get into my music video.
Let's do it.
So I have a music video that I'm just not really a fan of the video right now, but the song itself. So the video itself is not the greatest because it's just like a word video. Is that what they call it?
Yeah, lyrical video.
Lyrical video. So this is Pusha T featuring Jay-Z, Neck and Wrists, right here on Culture Cut.
Producer right here.
They like if Big was alive, Cole wouldn't be in this position. If Big had survived, y'all would have got the commission. Ho was gonna always be ho, but 'twas the universe will, 'cause the law says so, and now I'm here.
Beach with $1 million auto. Bring the cameraman, we can shoot our own knuckles.
Yo, honestly, a bunch of my favorite artists all on one track to begin with. The beat was fire. Of course, the producer in the building, you know, the boom bap guy, the hip hop guy comes out with, like, Video's all right, but, like, the beat and the features on that and all the artists on that were super, super fire.
I mean, it's Pusha T and Jay-Z produced by Pharrell with Pharrell singing on the hook. I don't know how much better it can get than that, man. I got to plug this song because, like, it's just so good, man. Like, oh, it's like the bass is banging. It's like a good club record, but it's also got lyrical stuff on it. I mean, Jay-Z just went
dumb. It's a good club record, but I would also, like, ride out to that.
You know? Oh,
I
mean,
like,
totally.
I would just be, like, riding into the sunset with that.
Yeah, man, the bass is crazy. Like, Pharrell's just
a monster.
Another level, man.
Monster.
I love the guys who stayed relevant through time. Like, that's just such a good example. Like, Jay and Snoop and Pharrell and all these people who've been putting out records for years, that they're still just as relevant today as they
were. About consistency.
Yeah.
Well, boom. I was gonna say, like, that's something that's novel to, like, I think our generational period, but, like, you gotta think about it. Like, how old was Marvin Gaye when he was at his peak? Like, how old was Teddy Pendergrass?
Yeah.
So it's like, when I think about, like, Chaka Khan and, like, superstars and even, like, you know, like, Diana Ross, like, they had long-standing careers. I think, like...
So you're saying I still have a chance.
Well, I just feel like I think we have a lot of life to live. Like, we get to our 30s and our mid-30s, and everyone's like, oh, like, you're 40 years old. Can you talk about anything? But in reality, it's like, can you talk about anything up until you're able to get to? Because we all know what happens with these, like, teeny bopper pop stars that come out. That's why, like, Olivia Rodrigo, right? Everybody was able to relate to her music because we're all like, oh, shit. Like, she's 17, but she's talking about, like, you know, like, 17-year-old stuff, but it's in a way that's, like, so real, and it's less like Hannah Montana.
I feel
like if we gave artists the opportunity to actually have, like, 10-year careers, realistically, things would get a lot better. I always like to say Beyonce versus Rihanna, and not in, like, a musical standpoint, but in terms of, like, when you look at albums dropped. Beyonce normally takes a certain amount of years before each project.
Sure.
When Rihanna came out the gate, she was dropping albums every single year for like 8 to 9 years straight. Yeah, and so everyone's asking her, where's the album? Like, chill. You know how hard it is to drop an album, let alone after like 9 years straight, like mentally what that process
is
like.
She's a businesswoman now
And so my whole thing is like, you gotta give a little bit of time for you to go through something to be able to get into the studio and write and create just as like a human being.
And create something authentic.
Like, yeah, and yeah. like, and then like be able to sit with the sound and like have it sound good. Like we all know how long it takes for an album to come out and for you to like, from the time like you get the reference to the final track. Mm-hmm. So I think that like, I don't know, man, we gotta have some patience. Like these dudes can all do it because like literally they've been working at a level where they're able to like, put out really, really great music in a short span of time because it's like, you know, what do people say? Like, you don't pay me for the job done. You pay me for like the all experience. Of the experience I've had to take to get the job done.
It's not about the 5 minutes, it's about the 40
years. Yeah, and so I feel like, you know, for the young artists, it's like, give yourself a little bit of grace and a little bit of time. Like you have, like, I think, is it better to be like, you know, at your peak in 3 years and at your peak in like five? Because I think about, like, if I'm still touring and making music after, like, 6, 7 years, that says a lot about my longevity than, like, if I'm at my peak in three and, like, can't sell out a venue, you know, 2 years after that. You know?
Totally. 100%.
We're trying to make legacy
here. Here we go.
Legacy albums, you know?
Legacy. I love it. I love it. I mean, that's actually funny you say that because, actually, that was my inspiration for getting into music. I didn't really care about the money. Like, I wanted to be a professional musician because I always thought the legacy, and you named some of the greats, like Teddy Pendergrass.
That's why I got into music, I'll be honest.
Yeah,
stop
Stevie
building
Wonder,
the monument, man.
Yeah, people like that who you remember, like, I still, Superstition bangs, bro.
Okay.
I love that shit. Like, I listen to that all the time.
That's in my emergency folder, actually. If the dance floor is ever clearing out, emergency folder, boom, that one's in there for real.
Hey, man, you can't go wrong. And so I think you're right. Like, that's a legacy record. Those are records that we're gonna remember a long time after, you know, somebody's gone, you know what I mean? And that's what I wanted to create. I wanted to create records. That's what I was saying earlier about chasing trends and stuff like that. Like, it is very, very tempting to do that because you can get fat paydays. And I know people who've gone that route and are doing well for themselves, you know what I mean? But like, I almost think sometimes that I'm like, I'm just, as long as I'm making enough to live, but I'm doing what I wanna do, I'm happy.
That's what it's all about.
I'm saying, so. But Sarah, thank you again for stopping by. It was great having this chat with you. A lot of awesome knowledge you dropped, so thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. It's always fun when I get to be with friends, talking about the industry, like in a very nonchalant type of way. Like, you guys are great. I love the show.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Where can our followers follow you?
So I am on Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. My LinkedIn is Sarah Maria, super basic. Sarah with an H, S-A-R-A-H. My Instagram and Twitter are both Sarabi247. So that's Sarah, S-A-R-A-H-B-I-247.
Perfect. Well, make sure you guys follow Sarah. And shout out to the Sound Collective again for having us down here at 28 Broadway in this excellent facility where we have our membership plan where all of our people out there who are watching the show can come in and jam and practice and join classes. And our subscription platform, which we're running right now on the website, for $24.99 a month, you can watch a plethora of videos. We have over 650 educational videos on there, as well as play-along tracks and live classes that happen Monday through Thursday. So everybody can get their continued education on and stay up to date with the coolest music trends. So shout out to Sound Collective, obviously, for having us on. And Sarah, thank you again.
No, thank you guys. What a great show. And thank you, Sound Collective, for the job.
There we go. Right there. There's the plug. I love it. We'll catch you on the next Culture Cut TV.
Bye.